Okay, anyways, what is a feminist to you? Well, a feminist is a person who in somehow works to get more equality in the world, and that would be social, political, and... I just had to translate it into Danish. So that would be social, political, and economic justice. And not just justice or equality, I'm sorry. Not just equality regarding sexes, but also equality regarding different social classes, different ethnicities, different sexualities, whether you have a handicap or not. So... for me, a feminist is a person who fights for equality in a very broad term of the word. And then it's up to the individual to interpret how they're going to do that fight. So if you're going to post, I don't know, your stretch marks on Instagram, you should do that. If you want to gather a lot of people and make a demonstration, you should do that. If you want to write an article and debate a topic. You should. So everybody is entitled to find their own way in feminism. Okay, what does it mean to be a feminist in today's society? I think I pretty much just explained that. So if I should elaborate, it would be that where feminism might have been more of a homogeneous, can you say that? Homogene, homogeneous, maybe. I'm not sure I have used that word in English before. group before, so it would be second wave feminists were pretty much white middle class women with the same types of problems. And now, today, feminism has to be intersectional, or else it doesn't really embrace all the different nuances of the problems we have. So I think feminism today has become way more diverse, and it is therefore, of course, being acted, because feminism is an act, I would say. It's something you do. And it's being acted out in so many different ways, especially the internet, of course, and social media has been a mind-blowing new way of doing everything in life, and therefore also activism. So where maybe 20 years ago, if you wanted to make an impact, you had to gather a lot of people physically, you had to walk in a demonstration, make banners, make something that rhymed that you could yell out loud, something like that. Today, you can actually change the world by making a hashtag. That is completely mind-blowing, but also a very interesting time to do activism. What are some of the biggest things, achievements, moments you have experienced within feminism and why? I think I could list several, but the freshest one, or the one that just pops to my mind, is when we achieved, and I say we because that's definitely not just my accomplishment, but when we achieved the consent law this year. Yeah, right? Well, no, we met up in December, and then the law was put into effect, I think, by January 1st. And that is just the pictures from there. I feel like that's a picture I want to show my grandchildren of how I was a part of changing their lives. Because having the right to your own body is just so fundamental. And the fact that you didn't have that before the 1st January of 2021 is insane to me. And also the way so many organizations, whether they were NGOs or political organizations or also just influencers and individuals with like survivors with their story, how we all work together and how that togetherness made us so much stronger that we achieved to not only change the law, but also starting, hopefully, starting a cultural change, how we talk about consent now. Like, I didn't know the word consent when I was, I don't know, 15. Now I have 12-year-old sending me questions about consent. Like, that to me is such an achievement. Okay, I need to speed up because you have a lot of questions. How did your interest in feminist start? Well, I always say that I was, when people ask me, when did you become a feminist? I always say I was born a feminist, meaning that both of my parents are pretty non-traditional when it comes to gender roles. For example, my mom went to work when I was 3 months old because she was a leader and she was working in a theater and doing something she really loved. And then my dad stayed home with me the first 2 years of my life. And to me, that was just my normal. But when I look at the statistics now, I see that is not everybody's or hardly anybody's normal in Denmark. Actually, in Denmark, women take 90% of the maternity leave, which also explains why the word is called maternity leave and not paternity leave. Okay, anyways, I was always brought up to do what I wanted to do and what I was encouraged to do, what I was good at doing, and never really being presented by my parents with limits of my gender or of my sex. So I firmly believe, still this day, that I can do anything I want to do, and that it's some completely bullshit that I have to do something because I'm a woman, or I can't do something because I was a woman. And I think that made me very stubborn and in some way entitled to the rights that women before me have fought hard for me to have. So when I met resistance from other people or for society and the structures, I didn't become shameful or felt like I overstepped. I became stubborn and resentful and weirded out, because why the hell should I act a certain way because I was born a girl? That did not make sense to me, and it made me angry, because it was so unlogical. And I think that is really the foundation of my activism, that of course this is my right. This is my birthright, and nobody can take that away from me. And then I don't care what society think. I don't care what the normal is. Like, I truly believe that to my core. Okay, why is it essential that feminism be intersectional? Because if you don't fight for everybody's rights, then you're basically just fighting for your own rights. And that's not really feminism to me. That's just improving your own your own way of living. I think, to me, you really have to include everybody. Well, both because it's the most sympathetical thing to do and solidaric thing to do, but also because you can't really talk about equality in an isolated manner. So I am never going to be free before boys are free of their gender stereotypes. Like, as a woman, that is also the key to my freedom. I am never going to be free as a woman before a black woman is going to be free of her chains holding her down. So we are all intertwined in equality and equity. So therefore, it just logically makes sense that we work together, and therefore also work on topics that are not necessarily affecting our lives directly. How are some of the concrete ways we can fight for gender equality, and what can normal people, students, do? Well, I think, as I said, to begin with, that everybody have to find their own way of being a feminist. And also, it's not necessarily the need that everybody writes editorial pieces or do demonstrations. I think everyday activism is just as important. So when your teacher says, let's say you're talking physiology. I'm going to say this in Danish. I'm sorry about people. It's not very inclusive, but I don't think English words have the same effect on this. But if your teacher in biology talks about the female genitals, the labia, and call it skamleber, like, you should always just correct that to kønsleber. Because there is nothing to be ashamed of. When I hear random people on the street say that word, I'm such an asshole that I interject into their conversation, be like, there is nothing to be ashamed of. So it's called kønsleber. And I think also, like, standing up to people in your class, like, I have talked to a lot of school, a lot of students, female students, to be exact, who are just subjected to these kind of jokes. I don't really think it's really a joke because it's not funny, but about women being whores or women going back to the kitchen. And I told them, well, I think you should write it down every time somebody says that, and you should present that to the school leader and demand to have a safe work environment. Because just as in a workplace, that bullying or harassment is not allowed, then that shouldn't be allowed in your workplace either. So I think the little things makes such a big difference. Or just maybe something like correcting your friend. If your friend says, oh, she's such a slut because she kissed him or did that, or like, no. Well, first of all, we all sluts, because being a slut is awesome and fun. And second of all, there is, like, nothing wrong with being a slut, so stop using it as a derogatory word, or just maybe mind your own business. I think small things like that is what actually changed the culture. Okay. How are some of the what inequalities do people face because of their gender today? Oh, girl. If I had to come with, like, a full list of that, this interview would go on forever. But I would say, just scratching the surface, boys, of course, can't cry because then they're sissies. Being a sissy also is very restricting gender role. Boys have to be aggressive and assertive and take leadership and never ask for help, and they can't like the color pink or Ariana Grande, and they can never cry. Girls have to be soft-spoken, and they have to be a little passive and hold back and don't take leadership. They have to like pink, and they have to be very much interested in giving care and being focused on emotions and emotional labor. And then we come to all the people who don't fit the box, who are just simply looked at, like, completely being wrong for not fitting the box. So, like, I feel limited in my gender, even though I'm in the box, because the box is small and narrow and it restricts me. But living outside the box is even worse, because then you are all the time confronted with not conforming. Okay. In the next 10 years... Yeah, in the next 10 years, what do you hope to see change within gender equality? Well, this is going to sound very Miss America, I just want peace and love in the world. But I literally just hope that gender should never determine what kind of person you are. What kind of person you are should determine how you express your gender. So I think we need to stop trying to fit people into a gender box that they don't fit into. Like, nobody fits into the gender box, because the box is stupid and square, and people are not square. So we should just construct gender around people instead. Make it way more well, first of all, realistic, and second of all, playful. So I hope that in 10 years, we have just burned those boxes, because they literally don't do anything good for us. Some people might say that your way of empowering yourself is unconventional with your revealing pictures. Why do you choose to do that? Well, first of all, when you look historically at it, using your body is not a very unconventional feministic way of doing activism. Actually, that's maybe the most unconventional way. Feminists have been showing their tits for many years now and writing messages on them and just using the female body. And that stems from the fact that the female body has always been presented from kind of a male gaze perspective. And I don't think we can ever get to a point where there will be no meaning put onto the female body. So therefore, I would rather put that meaning on myself than have somebody else dictate what my body is and means. Do you get that? So it's kind of like the female body is a battlefield. And then I would rather be the general of the battle, calling the shots, than just sit back and have somebody else dictate what my body says and means. So why not use it? And then also, it's funny how this is a way of doing norm critical activism. You can kind of do two things. Either when people ask these questions, you can kind of defend and explain and be like, well, my body is my body and it's body positivity and I love my blah, 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 blah. Or you can kind of turn the microphone around and say, well, why should I have to explain myself? Why should I have to defend the way I am? We never ask women who post pictures of their children or of their cooking or of, I don't know, their cafe latte and their avocado milk. So why am I on the spotlight? That's because I'm outside of the norm. Well, maybe part of this is not buying the premise that everybody outside the norm have to explain themselves and defend themselves. Maybe that is actually the activism, that I should do what the hell I want and not explain it. Just like if a woman has hairy legs, why does she have to explain that? Why is that activism by itself? Maybe she just didn't want to shave her legs. Maybe it's just that. But this is the way, what's that word I'm looking for? This is the way that power structure works. That everybody who does what they're supposed to do, like when a boy puts on shorts and a t-shirt, nobody asks him, why did you put that on today? They just, oh, it's normal. Of course you put that on. If he puts on a dress, then you're all of a sudden a target of curiosity and questions. Why did you put that on? Is that a message? Is that a political statement? Do you feel like this? Do you feel like that? That is the whole root of this. Stop asking questions about people making choices different than you. Because when you ask the question, you put them in a position where they have to defend themselves or explain themselves. And this is not this is not like a dig towards you guys, because I understand you asking questions because you're curious students. But this is really a part of wearing people out, because it's easier than to just...